What's up? Merte here. Now that we're done with the inferior vena cava and the superior vena cava, let's finally cover the portal venous system. Now, the portal venous system is a system of veins that drain blood from the unpaired organs of the abdominal cavity. These are the large and the small intestine, the pancreas and the stomach, the gallbladder and the spleen. So, blood from these organs will eventually find its way into the portal vein, which go within the hepatoduodenal ligaments into the liver. It then bifurcates into the right and the left branches, then divides into smaller branches to supply the hepatic lobes. That's why we say all the medications that you take, all the food that you eat, once they're absorbed from the intestines, they will all go through the liver within this system to be processed and filtered before going into the systemic circulation. And keep in mind, this goes for the exocrine hormones from the pancreas as well, like the insulin. So the portal system is an extremely important system. It makes sure to include the liver to take part in processing stuff. So let's go ahead and see how these veins are arranged. So the portal vein is formed by three major veins, and these are the superior mesenteric vein, the splenic vein, and the inferior mesenteric vein. So let's go ahead and go through all the tributaries of the portal venous system, starting with the superior mesenteric first. The superior mesenteric vein passes on the right side of the superior mesenteric artery, and it goes behind the pancreas. It goes down and then terminates as the jejunal and the ileal veins. They both collect blood from the loops of the jejunum and the ileum. Then it has the right colic vein for the ascending colon, the ileocolic vein, which collects blood from the terminal part of the small intestine and the cecum, hence the name ileocolic vein. It also has a small tributary vein called the appendicular vein, which receives blood from the appendix. Other veins that drain into the superior mesenteric are the middle colic vein, which collects blood from the transverse colon, and the right gastro-omental vein, which collects blood from the greater curvature of the stomach and the greater omentum of the peritoneum as well. So the superior mesenteric receives blood from all of these veins and dumps them into the portal vein. Awesome. One down, let's do the inferior mesenteric vein. The inferior mesenteric vein, as we said, usually opens into the splenic vein behind the pancreatic head. But keep in mind that veins are very variable. There are some cases where it can open into the superior mesenteric vein as well, or directly into the portal vein. But in the majority of cases, it's going to open into the splenic vein. And keep in mind that when we say the portal vein is formed by the mesenteric veins and the splenic vein, in reality, it's formed by a lot of different tributaries. But the mesenteric veins and the splenic vein, these are very large veins within the system. And since the majority of blood that the portal vein receives come from these three veins, we say that it's usually formed by these three veins right here. So that's why the inferior mesenteric vein, even though it doesn't directly open into the portal vein in the majority of cases, it still receives a huge majority of blood from the inferior mesenteric vein. That's why in some sources, you will find that the inferior mesenteric vein takes part in forming the portal vein as well. Alright, so the first tributary is the superior rectal vein, receiving blood from the superior part of the rectum, or the rectal ampulla. Then we have the sigmoid vein, which collects blood from the sigmoid colon, and the left colic vein for the descending colon. So again, the inferior mesenteric vein collects blood from all of these veins and dumps them primarily into the splenic vein. So let's now cover the splenic vein. The splenic vein originates from the splenic hilum, as you see here. Then it passes behind the stomach and the pancreatic body to join the superior mesenteric vein in forming the portal vein. So first off, it has a vein that communicates with the right gastroomental vein, called the left gastroomental vein. It has a short gastric vein, which goes up and drains the fundus and the upper greater curvature of the stomach. Then it has the pancreatic veins, which arise along the surface of the pancreatic body and drain it into the splenic vein. And so just to visualize it a little better, here we see the portal vein, the superior mesenteric, the splenic vein, the inferior mesenteric, and here are the pancreatic veins. And as you see here, the splenic vein goes behind the pancreas, and the pancreatic veins originate from the body and the tail of the pancreas to empty into the splenic vein. After that, the splenic vein empties into the portal vein. So that was the splenic vein as well. Now, let's go ahead and cover the tributaries of the portal vein. First, we have the left gastric vein, which collects blood from the lesser curvature, as you see here. And it also receives blood from the abdominal part of the esophagus, as the esophageal veins. Then the left gastric vein will anastomose with the right gastric vein to form a venous arch along the lesser curvature. So the right gastric vein will collect blood from the lesser curvature, and it will also receive blood from the prepyloric vein, draining the pyloric part of the stomach. So that's these two. Then we got the pancreatic duodenal vein, which collects blood from the head of the pancreas and the duodenum as well. And then it empties into the portal vein. It can also empty into the superior mesenteric vein sometimes. It depends on the source you're studying from. Then there's the cystic vein, collecting blood from the gallbladder. And then we got the paraumbilical veins, which are two thin veins passing along the round ligament of the liver to drain blood from the anterior part of the abdominal wall and some parts of the diaphragm as well, directly into the liver. And keep in mind that it does communicate with other veins of the anterior abdominal wall as well. So that was all the veins of the portal venous system. All of these veins unite to form the portal vein, and the portal vein goes into the liver and branches off to various lobes, and then the right, intermediate, and the left hepatic veins drain blood from the liver into the inferior vena cava. So that is how the blood goes from the portal system into the systemic circulation. Alright, now there's a concept that you need to be familiar with because it's very, very clinically important. And that concept is called the Porto-Caval Anastomoses. This is an anastomosis, or a connection between the tributaries of the portal vein and the superior or the inferior vena cava, hence the name Porto-Caval Anastomoses. Now, here I've combined all the portal veins. Under physiological condition, blood flows from the portal vein to the liver, right? Under any circumstances that make the blood pressure in the portal system increase, there's going to be a problem, right? This condition is called portal hypertension. So just to throw in a couple of examples, if there's chronic damage to the liver due to excessive alcohol consumption, or non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, or hepatitis C infection, or, you know, other metabolic causes, the body is going to replace the damaged cells with fibrotic tissue, right? Called liver cirrhosis. It could also be prehepatic causes like portal vein thrombosis or any external compression of the portal vein by masses like a tumor, or post-hepatic causes like right-sided heart failure, because remember, if the right side of the heart is failing, the blood will start to build up in the superior and the inferior vena cava, which in turn also congests the blood inside the portal system. So whatever the cause will lead to portal hypertension. Now the blood needs to escape the portal system, right? And since it's not flowing through the liver as efficiently as you want it to, it has to escape through other places, through the portal-caval anastomoses. So blood flows through these veins normally. But if there's an increase in portal pressure, the anastomotic veins will also start to congest, leading to varices or ascites. So let's go ahead and go through the portal-caval anastomosis a little bit. Through the esophageal veins, blood will go up to the esophagus and anastomose with the esophageal veins of the esophagus and the hemiesophagus veins, and then it will flow into the superior vena cava. So, in other words, there's an anastomosis between the esophageal veins. Now, suppose there's an increased pressure in the portal system. In that case, these veins will start to get congested with blood, leading to esophageal varices, which can be seen during an upper endoscopy. Then there's an anastomosis in the rectum, and this anastomosis happened through the superior rectal vein that drained into the inferior mesenteric vein, the middle rectal vein that drains into the internal iliac vein, and the inferior rectal vein, which drains into the internal pudendal vein. if there's an increase in portal pressure, blood will get congested in the hemorrhoidal plexus, forming internal hemorrhoids. Now, just keep in mind that increased portal pressure is an infrequent cause of hemorrhoids. So if you see a patient with hemorrhoids, the chances of it being because of increased portal pressure are low. But, you know, theoretically it's possible. Alright. Then there's an anastomosis between the para-umbilical and the subcutaneous veins around the umbilicus. When these veins enlarge, they get the term caput medusa, or head of the medusa. The name originates from the apparent similarity of Medusa's head, which had venomous snakes as hair. So they ended up calling this condition after her, because they look alike. And these anastomoses happen between the thoracoepigastric veins, which open into the axillary vein, and the superficial epigastric veins. And this condition is also very characteristic for portal hypertension. Other signs are, you know, when you have congested blood, water starts to go out from the veins, filling up the peritoneal space, leading to ascites. So that was all I had for the portal venous system and its anastomoses. I really hope you found this video helpful. If you did, please put a like, comment, and subscribe. See you next time.